Okay, so today and tomorrow we are going to be making treasure journals out of a book and creating signatures to put into that old book. And so we need a book and we need lots of papers, which I see that many of you have, and you probably can find more if you want to. You need a ruler. Any kind of ruler will do. You will need some sort of X-Acto blade and a self-healing mat. And I like to have two different size scissors. If you have a paper cutter, that's great. I usually use this plus my X-Acto knife. Pencil, which goes with the ruler. These are two different kinds of bone folders. These are used to make a sharp crease in a fold. If you don't have one of these, you can just as well use the back end of your scissor handle. It works just as well. I'm one of those people that loves to get art materials whenever I can, so that's that. Ideally, for tomorrow, you will need some double-sided tape. And I have these two different tape runners, which are great. They're permanent. They're two-sided tape and they don't leave a mess. But if you don't mind having a mess, then glue stick is great. All kinds of glue sticks. My favorite at the moment is this one, which is called G-L-O-O, glue. I will put links to anything I mentioned, but this is from jetpens.com, J-E-T. P-E-N-S, and it smells good, and it's really strong glue, and there's a lot of it in there, and it comes out blue, dries clear, so I love that. You'll need a couple of clothespins, paper clips, anything that can hold your pages together while you're piercing and sewing them. You'll need some waxed linen or strong thread, and tapestry needles, which have a big eye. I don't know if you can see that. There you go. Big eye. And that helps a lot for stitching your signatures. You'll need a book awl or something to pierce the pages. This one I love because it's tapered. And those of you who got a kit from me will have one of these. And it means that you can have a very fine hole or you can have a bigger one. And for this exercise today, for this project, I always go all the way to the top of that. Okay. You will need a old, big, thick phone book or catalog. And what we do with that is open it up. And this is where we will, when we're ready to put our signatures in to poke the holes, this is going to be like a cradle for that. So it's good to have something like this. It doesn't have to be this thick, but it's good to have an old catalog or phone book or something to use. And then I like to have a thicker scrapbook paper to make the cover of the signature. And by that I mean, so this cover is a little thicker than the papers that are inside, because just because this is the first thing you'll see when you open your book, and it's also nice to be able to attach some heavier things to it, make a pocket or something. If you don't have scrapbook paper that's thicker, that's fine. It's just over time I've learned that this works for me better than regular paper. I'm very hard on my books. And I just love this particular scrapbook paper. It's got images of Portugal tiles, and Portugal happens to be my favorite country. I used to have a second home there when I lived in England, and I've never gotten tired of it. This is another nice paper. I get them from all over the place. Some of them are two-sided, these are not. And I'll put some links down below when we're ready to finish for the day of where I get some of my favorite scrapbook papers. The other thing that I love to use is a corner rounder. And again, this is from Jet Pens. I'll put a link. I love it because it has three different types of curves that it does in a paper. And I like to round pages. I think it looks really nice. You can see I go a little overboard. Sometimes I'll do almost every page, but it just gives it a nice touch, I think. So I don't do all of them, but I do a lot of them. Okay. So those are, for the most part, the materials that we'll be using today and tomorrow. And then tomorrow, when we start really embellishing, I will go over what sorts of embellishments you might want. In fact, I'll do that before we finish today. Okay, just gonna pause recording. I am going to clear away all these papers and make room for my book, which I am going to deconstruct. And I will share with you my process for doing that. Okay. So what you'll need is your book, an X-Acto blade, and for now, that's all you'll need to do this part of it. When you look at the top of the spine of your book, and if you open both covers, some of your books will have a space, especially the older books. The newer books may not have such a big space. But what you're going to do, and you're going to do one side at a time, is you're going to sort of hold that apart as best you can. Get your X-Acto blade and be careful. You don't want to get your fingers, and you also don't want to cut through the spine itself. So if you just are able to get your finger in there and keep it away from the knife, you're going to just cut that paper down. I know I make it look easy, but I didn't do it right, so there you have it. You got to get it all the way down like that. So that's your first job, is to cut away one part of your cover so that it looks like that. And then you'll see why we want to reinforce the spine. Mine is just a piece of paper and then the cloth, and that's not going to last over time. Okay. So that's the first step, and then you do the same on the back, which is easier now because you can pull your cover around, and then you have a good area to cut straight down on this side without worrying about going through the spine. Now you've got this wonderful stuff to use in journals and collages and pages for other books, but for now I'm going to put that aside. And what we have is this very sad, messy book cover, which is old and has come apart, much like, was it Cynthia's whose came apart? So that is the first step. The next thing we're going to do is reinforce this kind of messy part. And like I said, I have Craftex, which is this stuff. It's like leather. It's called craft paper fabric. And I love it because it feels like leather. It holds like leather. And it's very easy to attach. So what I'm gonna do is measure. I'm going to measure this length, and then I'm going to add about an inch on either side of the spine. So I need to cut a piece of this Craftex. Let's see. That is about seven and three quarters. So I want to write that down. Get a piece of scrap paper. Okay. So 7 3/4. By about, I think I'll do 4. Because I'm going to be covering up this inside cover anyway, so this isn't going to show. Otherwise, if I didn't cover it up, it would show. I may want to leave some of this, but I can make a window in whatever I cover it with. So I'm going to move this out of the way. And cut this to 7 3/4 by 4. Okay. Pencil. So 7 and I think it was a little bigger. Put it there. The good thing about working on a grid mat like this is that when you make one mark, you can line it up with a line at the top and the bottom so that two. Okay, and you'll just cut that. This stuff cuts really nicely like paper. And then I need 4 inches this way. Might help to use the right side of the ruler. And you have lots left for next time. All right, bring my book back. And it's going to get glued in there. And you can use either side. I think they're pretty similar. Now this is a little tricky because of this big gap here. But what I'm going to do is, let's see if I can take this paper out because this is not helping. So if there's anything that's in your way, just remove it before you glue this reinforcement in. If it doesn't want to come out, that's okay. But very often there's stuff around here that you really won't be helpful. And so we want to get that out. Okay, I'm going to push this up together. Oops, look at that. This is an old book. What did I say this one was from? Let's see. This is from 1938. So that's why it's a little bit worn out. Okay, so I'm going to glue this close together here. So I'm going to start on this side. I'm just going to line it up so that it's sort of even. And I can use any number of glues that I have. I like using Fabri-Tac. I love this stuff. It's called Art Glitter, but it isn't like glittery. It's an adhesive that is very strong and dries clear. And it's made in Cottonwood, Arizona, which is the next town over, which is kind of cool. And then the other one you can use is the PVA, if you have that. And otherwise, just use any kind of white glue. I have a little handy dandy container. I just put any kind of white glue in. But I'm going to use my Fabri-Tac for this. I like this glue for this kind of repair. Okay, and I like to work in sections. I don't want to just put glue all over everything. So I'm going to first put it here, and this comes out clear and dries clear. So I like that about this glue. And because everything is so dry here, I have to work fairly quickly because otherwise it'll dry before I even get a chance to work with it. Okay, now this needs to be pressed down really hard. You can either use your bone folder or the back of your scissors. Just get it so that any glue that's gonna come out will come out now. It sort of squeezes out. And so Baby wipes are a good thing to have handy. And they will clean up any mess that you might make on your work surface. Okay. That's holding nicely already. And if it comes squeezing out, just wipe it away because you don't want it to get stuck on anything else. Okay, so now I have it attached to that part. Next, I'm going to turn this over and I'm going to put glue for this section here. So I'm going to just eyeball it. I mean, if you want to, you can measure how much that is, but I think I'll just pretend like I already know. And this looks like it could use a little help. And put an extra dose of this here. And then because there's a curve here, I want to really press that down. Clean up as I go. Sticking because it came squishing out there. I'm gonna get that off here because that will make things very difficult. Sorry for the shaking. The other thing you can do when glue is on a surface you don't want is let it dry and then you can just peel it off or use your X-Acto blade. So this is really gonna be a not very pretty cover, which I may end up covering this cover with something else, fabric or paper, or I may just leave it because there's certain beauty in old stuff, and I could color that. I could put washi tape on it, but I'm not going to worry about it for now. I just want to show you that things can happen and you can work around it. I'm just going to put a little more glue in there. Okay. And finally, we'll do the rest of the spine and the inside cover. Be stingy with your glue, especially those of you who live in a dry climate, you know what I mean. Okay. Some people use just cardstock for this or fabric. Some people use Tyvek, you know, those envelopes that come from, I don't know, FedEx, that weird material. That works really well too. So if you don't get this Craftek stuff, don't worry, because there's always something else that'll work. Okay. Now you've got to make sure that you can bend it. And that area here is where you're going to be putting your signatures. And we'll talk more about how many pages a signature should have, but you can get a pretty good idea that it's going to be at least two, right? And it might be three, but it probably won't be more than three. So now we can just let this settle down and dry. And we're ready for the next step. So we need to let this dry. We won't be needing to use this for a while. And so I'm going to put this aside, and then we're going to start talking about the papers that we'll use in the signatures. And I always say with this part of the workshop to really think outside the box. And I'm going to bring back this pile of stuff. And you all have your own papers that you're going to use. So I'm just going to go through a few that you may not have or you may not have thought of. So maps, this is just from some sort of accounting book. Paper bag, I do love using bags. Just a plain piece of copy paper is always nice. Children's book page. Graph paper. I like using graph paper because if you do want to write, it's so nice to have all these lines. This is just some kind of printed paper. This is fun. I don't know how many of you know about a website called The Graphics Fairy, but The Graphics Fairy is a great source of what they call printables. And they come in either just single images or sets. And so I download all kinds of images from The Graphics Fairy to use in books that might have a theme or to just give one page that, you know, is already kind of created for me. So I have a blank side and then this might end up actually being the center of my signature. Because whatever you put in the center is the only page you'll see both sides together. So sometimes I might use a piece of map because then you get to see if it's a special, well, that's not, but if it were a special one, well, that's Long Island. Anyway, so the Graphics Fairy, I'll put a link to them. It's a, you join it, I think it's about, I don't know, maybe $80 a year and you can download anything you want. But every Friday they have a freebie. So even if you just sign up to get an email, you'll get something fun. This is an old ledger paper. This is from a ballet book. This is my fake old Montgomery Ward catalog. Well, it's not fake, it's just a reprint. And that has some great images. This is some old paper that's been coffee dyed. Here's another page from that, the Graphics Fairy. And then let's see, this is either tracing paper, and this is vellum, which is a little stronger, but it's still, you can still see through it. So sometimes it's fun to put something mysterious underneath the vellum, and then that would be a page, and then that would be a page. So that's something. This is from an old book on various crafts, old crafts. This is just like brown paper, like from a brown paper bag, only it actually comes in a set of a package of it. I get a lot of my supplies on Amazon. So again, I can put links. Another vellum, and then you know, just plain old, lined paper, copy paper, more graph paper, and then another little bag. This can either go, I can glue it to a page, or I can fold it and have it be in the book. Some more of that printed paper. Some of you, if you got my package, will have something like this. Depending on the width of the book, I would either use this as it is, or that could be the middle page, and then you can color it Another old book page. This is from an old typing manual. And then one of the things I just love, I got an old yearbook on eBay. I think it was from 1949. I just love looking at, you know, who the officers were and you know, who was in the Honor Society. And then this woman had just tons of people sign her yearbook. So that was great. And then this is just a piece of thick colored cardstock. So I also like to use hand-painted papers. And this had some stamping on it. I was experimenting with stamping. Then this is just a piece of like brown tissue paper or deli paper. So these are the things that I'm going to be playing with for this book. However, I have a lot of work to do before I get started with that because I need to know how big to make my pages. And by pages, I mean all the way across, and then they'll get folded in half. So for instance, I think I may have already cut this to size. So I measure, that's the middle, and I measure almost to the edges. I mean, you could bring it all the way, and I may have some pages that do go all the way. Let's see. No, I actually don't like to go all the way to the edge because when you fold it, and you fold your book, they're gonna stick out if they're too long. So I measure this distance and then I cut these papers a little shorter. And let me show you what I mean. So the inside distance from one white edge to the other on this book is 11 and a half. It's 11 and a half across. And again, I'm going to make loops because numbers are not my thing. 11 and a half across. And then just the height of your reinforcement, not all the way to the top of the book, but let's see what this is. I think we already know that's pretty much 7 7/8. Okay, so those are the absolute maximum sizes that I could make my signatures, but I'm gonna make them smaller because I have found that they bulk up the book and then they're too long. So, let's see that one more time. So that's 11 and a half by 7 7/8. So this page that I've already cut is just under 11. Okay. So I've allowed for some room on both sides. And then the height of it is 7 1/2. So I have room on both sides here in the top and the bottom. So I am going to use this as a template for the papers that I'm going to cut. So just check again. This is 10 7/8. I hate those numbers, but oh well. By 7 1/2. So this is my work cut out for me. 10 7/8 by 7 1/2. And so I'm going to cut as many of these papers as I feel like cutting to this size. And then we'll meet back. So what I'm gonna do now is stop recording. Okay, so for the last however many minutes, I have been cutting papers to go in my signatures, and I had measured so that my papers were 10 and 7 eighths by 7.5 at the largest. But as you can see, I have some that are shorter, some that are lower down, higher up, but the largest of them all is the 10 and 7 eighths by 7.5. So I've got enough papers for 3 signatures. I'm not sure yet if I need 3. And then I've got 3 signature covers made of cardstock scrapbook paper. And so the next stage is folding. And for folding, you need a bone folder or back of a pair of scissors, because we're gonna fold each page and then really make a sharp crease. And this will ensure that they will all sit flat in your signatures. So just start with one of your signatures. I think I've got, 13 or 14 pages per signature. And again, I may not use all of them, but I wanted to have enough. So I can see that I've already folded some of them. And that one is already very tightly folded. And so you're just going to take each one. I'll just put these off to the side. Fold it in half. I mean, it's sort of a no-brainer, but I just want to show you to make sure you see what I'm doing. I'm going to bone fold it on both sides and make a pile. Okay, this one's already been folded. Put that over here. Here's a little one. That'll look cute in there. This is cardstock. I may not use it. This adds a lot of bulk, but I'm gonna prepare it and then I can decide later. It's already been folded, and that has vellum. This brown paper is good for collaging on. It's nice and strong. One got wet. It's a little wrinkled there, but I think it adds a little interest. It's very rare that I don't use a paper because it has something on it. I think sometimes I deliberately will spill some coffee on it or something just to make it a little less predictable. Okay, so now let me count this up. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. So that's about as big as I would want a signature. And so I'm going to do that with the other 2 signatures. But I also want to mention that you're going to be nesting them within the cover of your signature. So you're going to be deciding what order they should go in. And just as a rule of thumb, if something has text on it, then the next page, I want it to be either blank or colorful. And then I want something that has a little more interest after that. So I might put this in. Let's see which way, this way. And then there's white, so I probably want a color. And then there's white again. So maybe I'll put the text. And then white, but it's colorful on the inside. And so it goes until you get to the middle, and that's when you decide which page do you want to have in the middle, which is the only page that will show all of itself, you know, both sides of it. So I think I like to have the yearbook in the middle, but I think I'll put the vellum in the middle because then that lends a little mystery. So I still have a few papers left. So let's see where I can put them. Look at this brown paper in here. And maybe this purple. Plain white. And you can see it's starting to come together, and some of the pieces are sticking out. So I will take care of that. The thing to do also is to make sure that they are pushed as far into the back of the spine as possible. Okay. And I have this sort of brown tissue, which I will put there. So for now, this one I will consider finished at this stage anyway. It takes a while till I consider it completely finished, but I will go through it again and count and see if it's in an order I want, or do I want to move some pages. And then if I feel okay about it, I will close it up, put a paper clip on it, and then go to the next one, at least for now. Okay? So that's what we're going to be doing next, is folding and putting them in order. So go ahead and work on that, and I'll be back with you soon. So here are my three signatures with the papers in some sort of order. Start with the middle. So that's going to be a coloring page in the middle. Let's see. And then a ledger paper. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. It needs to get turned around. 15. So that is a little much, but for now I'll keep it. 15 is about the maximum you want, because it sort of puffs out and then it's a little harder to stitch in, but I've done it with 16. So 15 is okay. So I've now got three signatures of about between 12 and 15. And at this point, it's a good idea to see how they'll look in your book. So you can just sort of pop them in. That is a little full because I'm going to be adding things to them. You know, I'm going to be gluing things in. And so two things I've noticed. One is that these have too many pages, so I'm going to have to take some out. And the other is, they are sticking out of my book, which I don't like. Some people actually love having pages all over the place, but I prefer that they all stay within the covers. So I am going to have to, I'll go to my big paper cutter and I will trim these off. But that is the next job, is to see how well your signatures fit in your book cover. If you're not planning on doing much besides writing in it, then this would be okay. But I like to add stuff. So it's going to be too many pages per signature. So that's what I'm going to do next, is edit them down. I've just finished trimming everything down. And as you can see, it's still sticking out. So I'm going to need to take a little more time to make these signatures fit, because that will make me a little crazy if that is what my finished book looks like. A lot of people, it wouldn't bother. But if you have any OCD a little bit like I do, that's not going to work. So I'm going to take a little more time and trim these all down, and hopefully that is a lesson to us all that you don't want to make them too much bigger than the measurement of your actual book. I mean, you do want to make them smaller than your actual book, but maybe smaller than I thought. Okay, so I'm going to work on that, and I will check back with you shortly. So they've all been cut down to fit now, and everything looks pretty hunky-dory to me. So the next thing to do is to get out your bone folder one more time and really press your pages back into the spine as hard as you can, and then close the signature and bone fold the whole thing together. So that'll help it really stay together when you go to start poking the holes and stitching it into the cover. So just you press them all the way down into the back of the spine. Let's see, where's the middle here? There. The other thing to keep in mind is if you do have smaller and shorter pages, is do you want to center them? Do you want them to be, you know, up at the top or the bottom? Because you can decide that. One of the things to keep in mind, because we're going to be doing a three-hole signature, so we're going to have holes like one, two, three. So if you want this to catch two, then you would put it up where it'll get the first and the middle one. But if you're okay with it just catching one, usually that's fine. It can go in the middle. I love this image because what we're seeing are just the shadows. There's the camels, and these are the shadows. I think that's so cool. So I have a lot of these little pages. Some of them I'll put down lower or up higher. Love that one. Just leave it where it is. I know it seems like a lot of preparation, but it's worth it in the end, because what you'll end up with is a book that has the pages in the order that you want them in and in the positions that you want them in, you know, up higher, down lower. I have this little bag in there. I think I'll just put that right in the middle. So it's worth it to spend the time now so that you don't have to later. To really push it down to the back of the spine and bone folder, run that along the edge. Get as sharp of a crease as you can get. And that'll really help when we go to stitch it in. Then again, another question is what order do you want the signatures to be in? So I think I'm going to put the two that have the sort of Portuguese tiles, the front and the back, and this will go in the middle. And again, just check too many times. And that looks like it'll be good. So we are going to make a template next, and I will show you how to do that. You'll just need a piece of paper. Any sort of paper will do. So I have this. It just needs to be the same size as your book cover. So from the very top of your book down to the very bottom. Okay. This is going to be a template for your holes for sewing it in. And it's going to be an important part of the process because we're going to use it for however many signatures you have. So if you just have one, you don't need to make a template. But if you have three, like I do, then you want it to be the height of your spine. And very often, I will, that's cute. That's too cute to use. What am I doing? Yeah, I'll get a piece of this. Sometimes you got to look at both sides, right? Okay, I don't need it to be that big. I do need it to be at that length. Okay. And when you have graph paper or grid paper, you can just follow the line, which I love. No measuring needed. And then just, I don't know, maybe 2 inches across or something. More like three. Anyway, it just needs to be the length of the spine, and then you're going to fold it in half. Like that, and then you're going to fold it in half again. And because what you want to do is get the middle marked. So that's the middle right there, where the two folds meet. And that is the middle of your spine here. Then the other two is up to you. I usually do it about an inch, between about 3/4 of an inch to an inch from the top and from the bottom. I mean, you can eyeball it if you want. You don't have to measure, because if you just want to look at it and see, let's say that I want to do an inch from the top and an inch from the bottom. So there's my three holes. And the other thing it's a good idea to write, because it's off just a little bit, is to put a T for the top on the inside and the outside, because that could just be a little bit off here compared to here. And if I do this for one of my signatures, it won't line up with the holes that I have here. So the next thing to do is to also measure, measure these holes right in the middle. Because I have three signatures, I'm going to have one signature right in the middle of the spine. If you have two signatures, you mark the middle and then you mark an equal amount from each side of the middle. If that makes sense. So I'm going to just press really hard on these to get an imprint and see. So there's 1, 2, 3. Now, I'm not going to do anything with that yet, but I'm just measuring the three holes for the three stitches that I'll put in, the three holes here. And then because I have three, I want to have the other two holes equidistant from here to here, you know, all three of them. So again, I could measure, but I'm not going to. So I'm going to put the second one there, and there, and there. And if you want to measure, that's fine. So there's the middle, and I can see, you know, the wrinkly part is the edge. So there, there, and there. Those are the way the signatures are going to sit in the book, so that when I go to make the holes, they're going to fit along those dots. Let me just get one and show you what I mean. So there's the dots, those are the holes that are going to be holding that signature in place. But all of this is what we're going to do tomorrow. I just want you to have everything prepared so that when we start tomorrow, after a quick review, we're going to be able to start punching the holes and stitching it together. So we have our book cover reinforced and ready. We have our signatures ready. We have our template. Tomorrow, in addition to actually putting it together, I also want to consider what you want to do with the inside covers. That could be paper or fabric. And then the things that we'll need for tomorrow are the large catalog or phone book, so that you can use this as a place to create your cradle for cutting, for poking your holes. I also actually have what's called a book cradle. It's actually a pretty simple construction. It looks to me like two boards and two triangles and this thing that sticks through it all. Well, actually, no, it's two boards and then two end boards that are stuck in there. Anyway, the thing I like about it is that when you use it as a punching cradle, let's get to the middle here. So what we're going to do is something that looks like this, so that you're going to punch the holes. This catalog or this phone book works just as well, every bit as well. It was only after a few years of making books that I actually broke down and bought a cradle. So you'll need a punching cradle or a phone book or a large catalog. You will need your, whatever you're gonna be stitching with. This is all waxed linen, which is my thread of choice, but you can use embroidery floss. You can use, people use dental floss. And then you want your needle that has a big eye and it can be blunt on the end or it can be sharp. So you'll need those. You'll need your awl so that you can punch your holes. And then some of the other things that I love to have handy are scraps of papers. If you have something you've cut off, then these can make great pockets and what's called belly bands. So save and gather pieces of scrap paper to make pockets and embellishments. And also, if you have a hole punch, that's great because if you want to make tabs that stick out and have charms on them. The other thing that you might want, if you have it, just get my magic box of tricks here. This is called a crop-a-dile, and it looks really complicated, but really all it is two hole punches, two different size hole punches, and then this part, like it's got like a little tooth that sticks out, and this allows you to put grommets in place, and then the grommet holds the charm or whatever it is that you're going to be adding. And I have little containers filled with things I have bought over the years on sale at Joann's or Michael's, little charms, keys, crystals, and those are the things that I like to hang off the edge of pages. I also like to use something called bulb pins, which are shaped like a light bulb, and they're just a safety pin, basically. You can use a regular safety pin as well. That's to hold the charm. Okay. More charms. These are bigger. These are a little big for the books that we're doing this size. Like I say, I go a little crazy. How cute are these tassels, though? I mean, come on. Okay, then more grommets, lots of grommets. brads, which are these things that you push through and then open out. These are great for attaching cards or something like that. Oh, is this more charms? Yes, it is. Okay. These are something called hitch and rings. I actually don't use these that often. So what it is this thing that goes through the page or the cover, and then it has a ring like this. These are a little complicated to use, so I wouldn't recommend. I'm not going to use those. Ball chain is fun. You know, if you have ball chain, you can use that to hang stuff with. So get out all your doodads for tomorrow if you have them. Hole punches, doodads, all that kind of fun stuff. Scraps of paper. You're going to want your double-sided tape. So if you have one of these tape runners, this is a Scotch Extra Strength. I've also have Tombow. Lots of companies make these. And what I like about them is that you have refills, so that when this part runs out, which it will, because that's the tape, and when it all ends up over here, you can just buy a new one of these and snap it in. So you don't have to buy a whole new hunk of plastic. So that's good. You may want a needle and thread if you like to stitch things into your pages. You might want a stapler, any kind of thing that you think you might want to add in. You may want to have some white glue handy, your scissors, of course. And if you like stamping on your pages, you know, you may want to just get a few stamps and a stamp pad handy. Or if you like to doodle and draw, you know, just get a couple of nice pens that you can doodle on your pages. And so we are going to have fun tomorrow. We're going to be making all kinds of embellishments for our books, putting them together, and hopefully, for the most of us anyway, hopefully we will be able to finish them.